morning, Harvest. Go ahead and stand as we worship together today.
Power. Coming back to you, Jesus.
calling us, each and every one of us, to a deeper relationship with him. And maybe you don't know the Lord yet, and maybe today, as we pray in just a second, today is the day to bow your head and bow your knee to the Lord and say that I put my trust in you. I'm trusting in Christ for my salvation. But for those of us who have been walking with the Lord for some time now, repentance is really a part of our life that should be there all the time. But we want to provide a little space for that today. And what is repentance? It's turning from sin. It's coming into agreement with God about that thing. And what is sin? It's doing anything that's not in his word, right? Anything against his word. Anything that displeases the heart of the Father. And Psalm 24, it says, "Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? Those with clean hands and a pure heart." And the grievous thing about sin is that it separates us from the Lord. It puts a wedge between us and him. It breaks our intimacy and our fellowship with him. I'm sure you can feel it, you know, and that's in your life. You sense that distance with the Lord. And so we just wanna spend a little time here, just a couple minutes of just confessing some things to the Lord. 1 John 1 says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's a good, good father, and he loves us so much, and he wants that relationship, that closeness with us. So maybe you've seen in your life lately, maybe there's been some pride, maybe there's been lust, maybe there's been unforgiveness, maybe there's a root of bitterness that's been springing up in there. Maybe we've allowed some things to come before the Lord in our life. Let's just take a minute or two and just confess those to the Lord. Just say, I'm sorry, Lord, I'm coming back to you. I don't want these things in my life." Go ahead and do that now.
Thank you. his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
Have a seat. My name is John, and I serve as one of the pastors here, and it's great to be able to ascribe that worth right back to the Lord to gather here in this church, because He is a great God. And if this is your first time to Harvest, I'm glad you chose to be here today. We'd love to have an opportunity to serve you. I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby right after the service, and it's by a welcome counter. And so if this is your first week, maybe the best way to serve you is to get to know your name, and if you have any questions, or we have a class called Discover. It's just a real quick meeting after the service is over in our Hope Center. If you've got any questions or you're looking for ways to get connected here at Harvest, that would be a good next step for you. And I would also like to invite you, if you could take out your phone. We do this every week for a couple reasons. One, we'd love for you to be able to check in. Let us know that you're here today. But it's also a way for us to engage with each other during the week. So if you go onto the Harvest Bible Chapel app, the cool thing about that is you can put a prayer request in. If you want to get into a community group, you can click on one of the buttons there. And ladies, this is for you. In a couple weeks, we've got an event. It's a Women on Missions Worship and Prayer Night. So all the ladies from all the campuses invited to be here. And so Friday, May 3rd, from 7 to 9 p.m., you can find that on the app as well and register to be a part of that. So the app is super helpful. After the sermon today, there's going to be some growth questions for you that you can look at throughout the week to deepen your walk with the Lord. And so that's a little bit about the app and how it might be helpful and useful for you in the days ahead. You know, we're meeting here and we are gathering and worshiping the Lord. And there's another church really just a couple blocks away. It's called The Orchard. And Colin Smith is the pastor there. And we pray for local gospel churches every week. And I'd like for us in a moment to be praying for them and their impact that they're having in their community. I was talking to Brad, who's their campus pastor, and he said, man, we've got so much right now that we're watching the Lord do, and we would just pray for us that we can be able to have that impact in a way in our community like never before. And so thankful for them, and we'll be praying for them in a moment. But it's also a time for us as a church to bring our offerings before the Lord. And so each week we pause and we say, thank you, God, for being a God who provides our needs. Says, give us this day our daily bread, and He gives it to us. But I'd like to read this passage that says, or this verse, Psalm 117, verse 2 says, for great is His steadfast love toward us, and His faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. And so as we think about that verse and the faithfulness and the steadfastness of the Lord, why don't we pause and pray and thank the Lord for the many ways that He's intersecting in our life and showing Himself to be faithful and true. God, we love You, and we love the fact that we can pause in our week together as a church and just worship and adore You. We know that You provide for us in many ways throughout the week. You provide for us as we get to work and have interactions with people or at school or around the neighborhood. I'm thankful that You are with us always as Your children. And Lord, I'm thankful for the many ways that You provide for us. You show us Your steadfast love. You show us Your faithfulness. And would You today show Your faithfulness as Pastor Colin opens Your word and as he preaches, that those who gather at the Orchard today would be able to worship You and adore You and then go out on mission into the community and be able to let that light shine. And Father, I'm thankful that we right here in this moment right now pause and say thank You. Thank You for the many ways that You show us Your love, the many ways You show us Your faithfulness. And as we open Your word in a bit, Lord, would You continue to reveal who You are in ways that we might be able to fall in a deeper relationship with You. We love You and ask for You to do great things on this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
The hope of heaven before me, the grave behind. into the light of grace, just like Lazarus.
Thank you. really glad to be with you again, opening God's Word. Some of you, I know today, are like, oh, this guy again? Sorry. The reason I'm here, I'm on loan from the Chicago Cathedral, but the reason I'm here and get the privilege of serving, Pastor Jeff, some of you may have heard, had a heart procedure done. He had a stent put in, recovering very well, but continue to pray for him as he is continuing to recover and getting a little bit of rest. I know that he's looking forward to getting back in the pulpit, opening God's Word with you very soon, and so continue to pray for him and for his family as they're continuing to recover from all of that. But I hope that as we have been studying 1 Peter and in this series that we've been walking through, Strangers in a Strange Land, I hope that you've been growing. I hope that as you've had your eyes on God's Word and been internalizing so many of these things, I hope that you've been making some progress in your relationship with the Lord. That's something that I really value is growth and change. I'm aware daily of, minute by minute, actually, of how much in need of change, of radical life change to be more like Jesus Christ. And so it's something that I'm always valuing and always trying for. But if I can be honest, I can be a bit of a should person. You know, I should mow my lawn. It's actually a true statement. It's really bad right now. But I should mow my lawn. I should give some change to this guy on the side of the road. I should let that person go in front of me at the checkout line at the grocery store. But, you know, I've realized that identity is far more powerful than shame. That I am is much stronger than I should. Who I am is far more important than what I do. Because I want to be a good neighbor, I'll mow my lawn. Because I want to be a generous person, I'll give this guy a dollar. Because I want to be a humble person who serves others, I'll let them go first. Identity is more powerful than shame. I am is stronger than I should. And this is a key theme that Peter shows us in his first letter here. He tells us over and over to act like who you are. Your identity has been changed because of Jesus Christ, so act like it. Those who serve in the military are very aware of this. They come into service and they then act a certain way. Their schedule is a certain way. The way that they go about their life, even the way that they dress, all of it is radically changed, not just because it's something they do, but it's because of who they are. They are a soldier now. And there's a whole lot of things that come after that because of who they are, because identity is far more powerful than shame. It reaches into all areas of your life then because it's who you are. And if you have been found in Jesus Christ, you have a new identity in him. You are a blood-bought daughter or son of the King, so act like it. We're then called to be holy, to be different, to be completely holy. And because I like cute little clever terms, I've titled the message Holy, Holy. That we're to be completely and totally holy because of who we are. Not just because of what we do, but because of our very identity. Before we look at the text, let's take a moment and pray. Father, we're grateful for this opportunity we have to look into your word, and we're grateful for the fact that you've called us out of darkness and into your light, and you've called us to then act according to who we are and that new identity that we have. We would pray, Lord, that you would give us your wisdom, be with us today, and give us your strength and your grace as we continue, as we seek to love you and love others and serve you with our whole hearts, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, 1 Peter, if you're not, I gave you a bunch of warning there, but if you're not already there, grab hold of your Bible and turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to finish chapter 1 today, so 1 Peter 1, 13 through 25, looking at what God tells us about holiness and how we are to be holy because he's holy, and we're going to see three things. We're going to be challenged to live holy and imitation, and then live holy in fear and live holy in love. First, live holy in imitation. Let's start reading in verse 13 of chapter 1. Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope, remember we talked about this word last week, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is, here we go, holy, you also be holy in all of your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. As Peter begins this section where he's calling us to the holiness that we've been set apart for, he begins it with this word, therefore. And if you've been studying God's word along with us for any amount of time, you know that that therefore is pointing back to something that Peter has already said. And here it's referring to all of the blessings that we have in salvation. If you remember last week, Peter was talking in verses 3 through 12. He was reminding us of the inheritance that we have in Jesus Christ, of the secure hope that we have waiting for us in Jesus Christ. And because of that inheritance that is secure and is yours if you're found in Jesus Christ, nothing can change that. But because of that, we're to live lives of holiness. He's saying that that future incentive that you and I have, that's to be, that inheritance is to be an incentive for our holiness. It's been promised to you and it is secure. Nothing can change it ever. So live like it. That's what he's telling us, that our gratitude that we have in Jesus Christ, that's to be a motivator then for what he says, to set our hope fully on the grace that's given to us. Therefore, we should, you should, I should live our lives in a way that honors the Lord, not just because it's something that we do, but because it's who we are and because of what we have. So because you have been saved, act like it. Because of what God has done for you, live in holiness. That's what he's calling us to. And he says to prepare your minds for action. The literal Greek says, gird up the loins of your mind. That is a really strange way to say that. Gird up the loins of your mind. It's really strange for us, but what it points to is in their time, you know, they would wear like these really long robes everywhere. And so what it's saying to, what it's pointing to is when they would do something that was where they needed some action. Maybe they're going for a long walk or climbing a hill or helping a guy unload the groceries out of his Prius. I don't know. Whenever they would do some of those things, they would take their robes and they would pull them up and tuck them into their belt. So they would gird up their loins. That's what that terminology refers to, because an action was about to take place. They were getting ready for it. Really, the closest thing that I can think of that we have like this is roll up your sleeves and get to work. It's sort of like prepare for what's ahead. He says preparing your minds for action or girding up the loins of your mind. Notice, though, it's not just for action. It's not just because we're going to get to work. He's specifically targeting our minds, our patterns of thinking, the ways in which I would look at the world. He's saying here, be spiritually alert. Be ready for what's happening. Then he says, be sober-minded. It actually, in the original language, just says, be sober. But he means to not allow ourselves to have our thinking hijacked or sidetracked. Of course, when we think of soberness or sobriety, we think of alcohol or drugs or other substances. And I think those do fit here because those things do sidetrack our clarity of thought. But that's not just what he's talking about. He's not just limiting this to physical sobriety. In the context, he is talking about our minds. So are you sober is the question. Well, not just with substances, that too, but with activities and thought patterns that can sidetrack us, that can allow our minds to get off of what the Lord has called us to because of who we are. Even things that may not be wrong, but they're not always helpful in following the Lord. Things that cause us to lose our mental concentration as we seek to follow Jesus Christ. Even our career or accomplishments or fun things that we would do with friends, or maybe it's your kids' activities and your schedule, maybe it's your reputation or friendships that aren't helping you with clarity, follow the Lord. He's saying, set your hope fully on these things. Have clarity of thought about each of these things, and don't allow your mind to be sidetracked, because you are holy, so set your mind on what is before you. Set your hope fully on the hope. This was, again, was our word from last week. That's the confident expectation of what is coming for us in Jesus Christ. It's secure, it's certain, but it's not yet here. I haven't yet received all of it. But because we have that secure hope in Jesus Christ, we're to reorient our thinking and live soberly and alertly. That's what he's calling us to. And he tells us to do that as, what does he say? As obedient children. That because of your relationship with Jesus Christ, when you came to the point that you bowed the knee to Jesus Christ and trusted him by faith, you are a part of God's family. He is your heavenly Father, and you are a child. The adoption papers are signed and finalized. Nothing will ever change that. You are a part of God's family. That inheritance that you have now, it's secure. It's yours. But you can determine if you're going to be an obedient child or a disobedient child. And that's what he's calling us to. You're a child either way. That's your identity. So act like an obedient child is what he is saying here. Peter's calling us to this obedience. He says, don't be conformed to these things. Now, what is he saying that we're not to be conformed to? That we're not supposed to pattern our life after? He says, our former passions, the passions of the culture around us, the desires and the cravings that I used to have before I became part of God's family, I'm to turn from those. I'm not to be conformed by them. He's saying don't live your life around the patterns of thinking and the things of value that the world would value. The things that you used to value before you came into a relationship of Jesus Christ. He's saying, be different from all of that. Don't go with the flow in that. Don't be conformed, but be different. An obedience to God's word and a living a holy and a set apart life. It's completely different from living the way that those who don't love Jesus would live. And he's saying, don't fall back into all of those patterns. Don't act like you used to be. You're not like that anymore. That's not who you are. So don't act like it. Your eternity, your identity has been changed forever. So live like it. Live in that way. Live because of the way that your identity has been changed. Don't fall back into all of those patterns. Listen, you have won the lottery. You don't have to eat ramen noodles anymore. Amen. That's what he's saying. You're part of God's family. Nothing will ever change that. So act like your father. Live in holiness. He says in verse 15 then, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. He's calling us to imitate our father, like the little girl who would dig through her mother's closet and pull out the high heels and put those high heels on and stomp around, you know, scratching up the wood floor and all sorts of stuff. But she's doing all of those things because she wants to be like her mom, who she loves. That's the type of imitation that we're called to imitate our Heavenly Father as obedient children. And there's lots of ways in which we could try to be like our Father. Maybe in our generosity. God's been so, so generous with us. So let's be generous to others. Or what about in our forgiveness? God has forgiven me such an incredible debt. So I should forgive others. What about in seeking the lost? He has sought and saved the lost. So I should be about telling people about Jesus and trying to reach others because of that. And yes, let's do all of those and more that our Father would do. But what does Peter say here? How am I to imitate my Father? How are you to imitate your Father? It's in holiness. It's in being set apart. Holy means to be set apart. It literally means be different. Be completely other. In the way that you, a human, are completely other from your dog, as precious as that dog might be. Totally different in ways. That is how we're called to be. Completely different than the culture. Completely different than how I used to be before I met Jesus Christ. Because I have been set apart. I have been made holy already. And set apart for Jesus Christ. So I'm to live like that. To live in a different, set apart, special way. God's people throughout history, all through the Old Testament, they were to set apart certain items that were used in temple worship. Those things were holy. They were only used for that. They were special for something like that. God would tell his people time and time again to consecrate themselves, to set yourselves apart for worship of the Lord. The high priest would enter into the temple and the tabernacle before that, and he would wear a turban, and on the turban would read, "Holy to the Lord," reminding him that he was set apart for the Lord. And if you have been given that secure hope, that inheritance that never fades and never fails and will never perish, you have a statement above your head reading, "Holy to the Lord." That's who you are. So act like it. That's what we're called to do here. And throughout the Hebrew language, the use of repetition would be done in such a way to show the force and the significance of a thing. That happens through the Old Testament over and over. See what I did there? Just like that. Over and over. It keeps happening throughout Scripture. Jesus would say, "Truly, truly, I say to you." He's repeating, there's no stutter there. He's repeating himself for emphasis, for force, to say like, "Hey, listen up. What I'm about to say is super important. Truly, truly, I say to you." We see it through Scripture. God even declares about himself when he's telling who he is. He says, the Lord, gracious and compassionate, abounding in loving kindness. He's reminding us, this is who's saying it. It's me, the Lord. He repeats it multiple times for emphasis, for force and significance. And there is only one thing in all of Scripture that is repeated three times. We see it many places throughout Scripture. Isaiah 6 is one where the angels are in the throne room and they say one word, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." It's the only thing in God's word that's repeated three times to show us the significance, and the depth of that significance drives us, you and I, to live in that same holiness as we imitate our Father. Live differently, conforming not to the culture or your former desires or all of the things that I used to value. Don't conform to those things. Instead, conform to the character of your holy Father who's purchased you with the blood of Jesus Christ. So do your relationships, do they look different than those who are around you who don't have the same father? Are they holy? In the ways that you use your time, is it different? Is it other? Is it holy? More so than those who are at home in this world. Are you living in holiness? You've been called by God into a relationship with your Father. And so because of that, because you have a holy Father, imitate your holy Father. Put on the high heels and walk around, even clumsily at times. But do so to imitate our Father. Live holy and imitation. And then second, live holy in fear. Let's go back to our text, verse 17 and following. And if you call on him as Father, again, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in these last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. He's calling us to live holy in fear. He says there, conduct yourselves with fear. And fear, of course, we've talked before, it's not a terror in the way that we might think of it that comes to our minds first when we hear fear, but it often includes trembling. You know, it's like fire pit weather for me right now. I love going in the backyard, you know, my lawn that needs to be mowed. But I love going out in the backyard and lighting up a fire pit and hanging out with friends. And I had some friends over last week and we had the fire going and they have a toddler. And toddlers' fire don't mix real well. And so there's a whole lot of like, be careful, watch out, don't get too close to the fire. Instilling some fear in that toddler because of the fire. As I already said, I live in Chicago, and if you haven't been to the city recently, there are speed cameras and red light cameras everywhere. You don't even know you get it. You just get mailed a ticket now. It's kind of ridiculous. I'm grateful that my phone, you know, Waze will tell me, like, speed camera ahead. Oh, thank you. I will slow down. But I'm super cautious now because even though I know where all of those cameras are, I've been mailed 2 red light camera tickets. Both times I stopped and then turned right on red after I stopped, but the camera got me. Both of them I fought because you could see in the little video, I stopped. 1, 2, 3, and then I turned right. I know I kept the law, and both of them, they said, nope, you still get a ticket, because for each one, my front tire was just over that little white line. And because, now, no cop would ever give me a ticket. I stopped at the red light. So now I'm like, white line's over here. I'm way back here. I'm like, 1, 2, 3, now I can turn. Because I live in fear of those little cameras now. Because I've gotten tickets. There's a fear. I don't want to get a ticket in the future. That's the type of, it's talking about reverence. It's talking about awe even there. That I'm respectful of that camera. That there's fear because of what's on the other side. Isaiah 6, as I mentioned, is where the angels are there in the throne room, and Isaiah gets this beautiful and frightening vision of God seated on the throne with smoke filling the temple. And Isaiah's response as he sees this whole thing and sees the angels shouting and singing holy, holy, holy to the Lord, Isaiah's response is, woe is me, for I am lost. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. It's immediate fear as he experiences God's holiness. In the New Testament, Peter is in the boat with Jesus, and Jesus says, throw the net on the right side, and Peter hauls up this miraculous catch of fish, and what's Peter's response? It's not to jump for joy at all of the fear that he has. He drops the nets and falls to his knees before Jesus and says, depart from me. Get away, Lord. You're too holy. I can't be in your presence. It's fear. That's what he sees. It's reverence. It's awe. And Peter here calls us to have that fear. He says, throughout the time of your exile. Remember, you and I, we're elect exiles in a land that we don't belong in, but we're to conduct ourselves with fear, with reverence while we're here. And he says that the basis for that fear is because of what's been accomplished for you and for me. It's because we've been ransomed by the blood of Jesus Christ. You were on your way to hell, completely lost, without any hope for salvation, and Jesus said, you're mine. We sang that song a little bit ago that said, the enemy thought he had me, but Jesus said, you're mine. It's a beautiful line, but the truth of it is the enemy did have you. And Jesus said, no, mine. Set apart for me, ransomed for me, holy for me. That's what happened, and that is why we are to live in fear. His abundant mercy and grace, so undeserving I was, but he said, you're mine. You're holy. You're set apart for me. God purchased you. He ransomed you. The Bible says that you and I, we are slaves to sin. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, lost and dead in our sins, but God purchased your freedom by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And now you and I live in a holy reverence to a God who purchased us. We were ransomed from our futile ways, it says. All the meaninglessness that we see in this world. We studied Ecclesiastes for a whole lot of weeks where we continue to look at all of the things that the world would offer. And is there meaning in this? Is there meaning? And we came to the end of it. What was our word? Hebel. It's just fleeting and meaningless on this earth. But you and I have been called out of that and given a living and a secure hope, purchased our freedom because of Jesus Christ. All the chasing after the wind of our careers and our health and our happiness and all the fun things that we would try, it's all unsatisfying under the sun without the perspective of the hope of eternity that awaits us. And we have been ransomed out of all of that and given a secure inheritance that has been promised to God's people for generations. As Peter is writing this, talking about ransom, they would have thought immediately of God's deliverance of his people Israel out of Egypt, that he purchased them out of that. He ransomed out of their slavery, set them free to receive God's promised land and the inheritance that was promised to them. You know that Passover actually starts Monday evening at sundown. And that's a time when the Jewish people will remember that very thing, that God ransomed them out of slavery in Egypt. And Peter here is telling us that same exact thing, but we weren't ransomed just by a Passover lamb. We were ransomed by Jesus, the perfect Passover lamb, who here he says is without spot or blemish. That perfect lamb, Jesus Christ, he made a payment for your sins and for mine, and he set us free to worship him, but to do so in reverence, in holy fear, because of what he's done and because of what is to come. Paul will remind us of this same fear in Romans 14. He says, "Why do you pass judgment on your brother, or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God." Paul's writing this to believers, to you and I, and he says, we will all stand, every one of us, even those who have bowed the knee to Jesus Christ. Now, scripture tells us that there's no condemnation for those who are found in Jesus Christ. On that day, you will have an answer, but you'll still stand before a holy God. We will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God." So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Every single one of us will stand before a holy God. If you have believed in Jesus, then all of your sins have been forgiven and paid for. You have been ransomed. Again, there's no condemnation for those who are in Jesus Christ. It's not like many who believe that you'll stand there before the judge, the Lord, and he'll bring out this massive scale, and on one side are all of the good things that you have done, and on the other side are all of the evil things that you have done, and you just cross your fingers that it tips in the right way. That's not at all how it works. Scripture, again, says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You're guilty. You'll stand before a judge guilty. You've broken God's law. You've been sentenced to death by a righteous and a just God. But in that moment, he ransomed you. He made the payment for your death penalty that was there. He ransomed you. There's no payment that's needed on your behalf. Jesus Christ has done all of that and has washed you clean and set you to freedom. And it is a miraculous truth, but this scripture and Paul in Romans 14 and many others will tell us that we'll give an account to God someday. It does tell us that we'll stand before God on that judgment day. Now, I don't really know what it looks like. You'll be happy to know that as one of your pastors, I have read the whole book. But it doesn't really tell us exactly what that's going to look like for the people of Jesus Christ, but it does tell us that we'll stand before him. Like, I don't know if there's a giant TV and all of the things that I have done will play there. Jesus does say that every careless word spoken, we will give an account for. I don't know if an angel will come out with a list of all of the sins that I've committed. I mean, it would be long for me, like CVS receipt long. I don't know if it's like that, but I'll just say for me, I've done enough evil. I've done enough against the Lord that when I hear that I will stand before a righteous judge and give an account of myself to God, gulp. It brings fear. I'm not going to lie. Even knowing that Jesus has paid for all of my sin. I mean, we're told that we have boldness to approach the throne of grace, to receive mercy in our time of need. And if you're found in Jesus Christ, you have all of that. And if you're found in Jesus Christ, all of your sins have been forgiven, but you'll still stand before the Lord at some point. We will give an account. And there is nothing more that I want to hear than, "Well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master." So until that day comes, we seek to live holy lives of fear and reverence before the Lord. Live holy in fear. And then finally, live holy in love. Let's go back to our text, 1 Peter 1:22 and following. He says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since you have been born again, not with perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. And just as we studied how Peter had talked before about being refined like gold in a fire, here again he says that our souls have been purified, that he's purified us. Now there's a statement that's attributed to Michelangelo when he was asked about the famous sculpture, the famous statue David, of how he made that. He said, well, I just chipped away anything that didn't look like David, until that's what was left. And who knows if that quote's actually from Michelangelo or if it's just made up. But the principle here is true, that there are parts of your life and my life that aren't like Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit, by his grace, is purifying our soul. He's chipping those things away that don't look like Jesus. He's purifying you. And notice he's doing that by what? By your obedience to the truth. He tells us that we've been born again through the living and abiding word of God. Things come and things go and they fade just like grass, this text says, but God's word remains forever. Nothing can stop the word of God from advancing and accomplishing the Lord's purposes. And Jesus told us that if we love him, if we truly love him and follow after him, then what? We will obey his commands. We'll follow his enduring word because it never fails. And Peter does mean all of God's word, I think, when he's saying this, that we're to be in obedience to all of God's word. But I think most specifically here, he's talking about the message of Jesus Christ. He's talking about the gospel. He's talking about the fact that you have turned from your sins and through obedience trusted the word of God, the message of Jesus Christ, that he on the cross paid for your sins and set you apart for God. That imperishable seed that then takes root in the soil of our hearts and grows to a beautiful and fruitful and magnificent harvest of righteousness to God. Because the outcome of God's word dwelling in you is a greater obedience to Jesus Christ, and more specifically here, a more significant, a greater love for others. That's what that obedience looks like. That's what the reality of who you are in Jesus Christ, the fact that you've been set apart as holy, it comes out in a fruit of a love towards one another. Jesus taught us this often, a familiar passage, Matthew 22, with the crowds around him. One of them, of the crowds, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? What's the greatest thing? What's like the main thing that we're supposed to know? And Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind. This is the great and the first commandment. The first is love. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. This is the greatest thing that Jesus calls us to and his followers, is an increasing love for others. It's the greatest indication of a true love for God. Later in this account, we see it in Luke 10. It says that he, desiring to justify himself, the lawyer who received this answer, he asked Jesus, well, okay, so I'm supposed to love my neighbor as myself. Who's my neighbor then? And Jesus tells this parable, one that we're very familiar with. It's the parable of the Good Samaritan. And Jews and Samaritans at that time hated one another. They wanted nothing to do with one another, so much so that they would go out of their way on their travel routes so that they wouldn't even go through each other's land. And this Jewish man was walking down the road in the parable that Jesus tells, and he falls among robbers who steal everything that he has. They beat him up and strip him naked and leave him for dead on the side of the road. And a priest walks by, and surely this pastor will stop and help the man who desperately needs help, who's in need of love, but he doesn't. He walks clear on the other side of the road. After him, a Levite comes, another holy man, but does the same thing, walks on the other side of the road, unwilling to help his brother and show him love. But then a Samaritan comes, and all of Jesus' listeners would have been like, ugh, a Samaritan. The Samaritan, even despite the cultural differences that they would have and the fact that they were supposed to hate one another, the Samaritan, though, stops and helps the man and binds up his wounds and gives him food and water and clothes him and puts him on his donkey and takes him to a hotel and pays for all of his expenses and feeds him and then gives the hotel owner even more money and says, here, this will help take care of him because I got to go, but if it's not enough, I'll take care of anything that's needed. I'll come back and I'll pay it all. This man who he doesn't know at all, this man who he's supposed to hate even, but showing immense love. And Jesus's point in all of it, in telling us that, is that this type of love is different. This type of love is holy. We're to love in a holy way, a different way. It's not difficult to love people who do good things for you, who you love to be around. It's not difficult to love a newborn baby. They're so precious with those cute little cheeks, and I love their little feet and the way their forehead smells. It's not hard to love a newborn baby. It does become a bit more difficult when they get older and they tell you that they hate you because you've set some boundaries for their well-being. It's not difficult to love a person who seems, every time I walk up to this person, they just seem to just fill my cup. I walk away feeling just so much better, and God bless people like that. But it's not difficult to love those types of people who fill your cup. It's a lot more difficult to love those people who seem to find a drill to the bottom of your cup every time you walk up to them. It's more difficult to love people like that, and we're called to a different kind of love, a love that loves those who are different from us, a love that loves those who are difficult for us, a love for those who hate us even for our enemies. We're called, Jesus tells us, to love even our enemies. And why? Why enemies? Because I was an enemy and God loved me. Because you were far from God and God loved you with a holy and a different love. And we're called to imitate that kind of love. I've said it before, love is joyful sacrifice for the good of another, sometimes accompanied by feelings, but always accompanied by action. If you display a little effort in a relationship, in a dating relationship, in a marriage, with your family, with a friendship, if you display little effort, you're showing that you only have a little love to give. But if you display great love at great cost to yourself, then you're on it. with holy love. That's joyful sacrifice for the good of another, maybe accompanied by feelings, but always accompanied by actions. So I have to ask, and Peter would ask, so are you loving? Like, are you really loving in a holy way, in a different way, different than the world? Are you increasing in that love for others? Because we're called to be holy, to be different, to be set apart for his purposes. So what are the practices? What are the actions, the thought patterns, the attitudes that then I need to change so that I can be different from this strange land that I don't belong to? Because you and I, we've been called out of darkness and into light, out of this world and into a heavenly inheritance. And we've been given a living hope that is secure. We have an enduring grace for all of eternity. And we are a holy people set apart for the purposes and the pleasure of our heavenly Father. So live like it. Live in holiness, because our identity is way stronger than our I should. We're to live in holiness to a Father who's purchased us out of sin and out of darkness and called us to be different in this world as exiles. So let's live for him, because it's who we are. Father, we're grateful for your word and the ways that you instruct us from it. We thank you for your purposes that you call us to. We thank you for the identity that you've given us in Jesus Christ and the way that you've changed us. We would pray that you would allow us to live in congruence with that, Lord. Live as you have done, to be holy as you are holy, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand.
Your promises, they all come true. God, we will fix our eyes on you, 'cause we believe you're coming soon. Isn't that right? Yes, we will fix our eyes on you, so promises they all come true.
Opportunity for you to meet some other people who are new. It's called Discover Harvest, and it's going to be taking place in the Hope Center. But you know, all of us heard the same thing today. It was a challenging word. We're strangers who live in a strange land, but it's a hopeful word because it really can affect us today and tomorrow and the rest of this week. As you and I are going out on mission, we can love like Jesus loved, and we can do that in a greater way. We can communicate that truth in a way that people can see that, man, there's hope in Christ. So we get to be imitators this week. And as we are imitators of this King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as we go out on mission to represent him well, remember this, you are loved. Have a great week.